Ukrainian parliament today voted to drop the country's neutral non-aligned status in a landmark step that will bring it closer to NATO membership. But the Russian foreign minister calls the move counterproductive, adding that it would only boost tensions around the crisis in the east. Addressing deputies in Kiev before the vote, Ukrainian Foreign Minister Pavlo Klimkin says scrapping Ukraine's neutral status highlighted its determination to pivot towards Europe and the West. Ukrainian President Petro Poroshenko says the non-aligned status provided no guarantees for its safety and therefore needed to be cancelled. Non-alignment of Ukraine was secured by a law signed by the then President Viktor Yanukovych in 2010. The law stipulated that Ukraine did not seek to join military political alliances. Now joining us via Skype to discuss this issue further is political expert David Thring. Dr. David Thring, thank you for joining us this afternoon. Now, Ukraine move to drop the non-aligned status. Is it the wrong move at the wrong time?
Yes, I think so, because first of all, there's no threat. They talk about needing to be aligned with somebody in order to avoid a threat. But in fact, non-aligned status isn't really part of any sort of global threat at the moment. And first of all, the move in the world at the moment is against the kind of wars that the Americans have been, along with NATO, have been foisting on innocent other countries like Afghanistan and Iraq, to name the latest few, Syria, of course, even later. And the rest of the world, which is mostly non-aligned, with the West, is against this. We want to see a peaceful resolution of conflict, and certainly no conflicts that are started on the basis of lies and disinformation and false terrorist accusations. So it's the wrong time when the rest of the world is moving towards non-alignment, and especially at a time when the United States and its allies are suffering from overkill in two senses of that word. They've been killing more people than they ever needed to do in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Syria. They didn't need to kill anybody at all in the first place. So they've become unpopular in the world from a moral point of view. And of course, these wars have drained their economy as well. And I think, thirdly, they've probably antagonized large sections of their own population, certainly in the UK, parts of Europe, and large parts of America. There's a strong feeling that the government is taking them into wars that nobody wants. They're not in the interests of the United States, or anybody else for that matter, apart from a small clique of people who run the State Department, mostly under the
Ukraine is not looking laterally at the rest of the world, as you say, that is moving towards non-alignment, and that its aim is that Kiev will eventually join NATO, raising the possibility that it could one day face Russia militarily. Now, what are the dangers of that?
Well, of course, the main danger is that facing Russia militarily is a recipe for a conflict on their soil. And that conflict won't be in their interests. It'll be in the interests of those neocons that I was speaking about earlier, who fear Russian power in the world and want to do as much damage to the Russian forces as they can, both in terms of propaganda, i.e. blaming Russia for starting such a war, and in terms of military hardware, in other words, destroying some of Russia's capability. So it's a danger for Ukraine to take this stance. To put themselves in the middle of what might be the beginning of a Third World War.
Now, we know that the usual accession to NATO takes at least 3 years. Now, would it be probable that, why is Ukraine rushing when it's already facing a crisis itself now?
Well, I suppose it's understandable that they want to crush the Russian-speaking so-called dissidents in the East, and they can't obviously do it themselves because their forces have had to withdraw from the conflict. But I think it's also a lie because only this morning, apparently, the the NATO Council was talking about joint operations in Ukraine. So they're saying one thing strategically, but in tactical terms, they're doing something completely different, it seems.
Now, we know that NATO's eastward expansion has always been a sticking point regarding relations with Russia. Why does the West continue to break its promise to Moscow?
Well, I think this is now due to the problems in the Middle East. The Europe is being driven again by the United States State Department, which has vested interests in the Middle East, mainly defending Israel. And the problem that raises is that the Russians, who are generally supporting peaceful countries like Syria, although portrayed in the West as being antagonistic, is actually trying to solve its own internal problems, and it's doing it internally, unlike NATO and the United States, who are bombing countries that have nothing to do with them. And I think the problem that our alliance on the West has got with Russia is that Russia is supporting the Syrians, and that's not in the interests of the Israeli lobby on Capitol Hill.
Dr. David Thring, political expert, thank you very much for joining us.